What's the best nutrition for panic and anxiety? And what else besides nutrition can be done about it? Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode. Forrest says, what are the top interventions for panic and anxiety? Nutritional was my main question, but anything else is of interest. Panic and anxiety, methylation factors driving the relative rigidity versus flexibility of the mind. I would expect rigidity to favor panic when there are other factors, and also generalized anxiety, when there are other factors that favor the things that are being rigidly focused on as panic or anxiety producing thought patterns, thoughts, or emotional patterns. And then histamine, I think, is very often overactive in the brain, which at healthy levels contributes to alertness, but at overactive levels will contribute to generalized anxiety. And I believe can also produce an episode of panic when acutely and extremely elevated. Methylation is also important to minimizing histamine, actually. So methylation is overwhelmingly important. I do think that other factors impacting dopamine can be relevant in the sense that one of the main way that methylation regulates mental rigidity is through increasing the pool or decreasing the pool of tonic dopamine, which favors mental flexibility. And so you can also favor mental flexibility by increasing the activity of dopamine receptors that mediate the phasic response to dopamine. And I think vitamin A is an important factor in that. I also think endocannabinoids derived from arachidonic acid and the classically understood ones increasingly thought to be also derived from omega-3s can also regulate dopamine metabolism in a way that is favorable for reduced stress response and increased mental flexibility. Generally, I think, you know, certainly B12 is critical to mental health. Generally, meat, bones, and skin, like a balanced nose-to-tail animal product is probably going to be the best way to deliver the key nutrients that are often missing, which is consistent with diets, you know, vegetarian and vegan diets being associated with those things. Although the interpretation of that data is controversial, and I'm not saying that you can't have a healthy vegetarian or vegan diet. It's possible for some people. And then there's that aspect. So nutritional was the main thing. In terms of non-nutritional strategies, I think meditation can go a long way towards, and other mindfulness techniques can go a long way towards being able to step outside of your own thoughts and become an observer of your thoughts rather than a victim of your thoughts. And I think seeing a therapist, reading, doing the work to understand your thought patterns and to implement and execute new thought patterns can be very helpful. Pulling the GABA lever can obviously be helpful, as evidenced by a lot of the non-SSRI drugs that are used for anxiety. GABA has been shown to help decrease brain waves associated with anxiety and decrease the stress response in response to exposure to phobias. So supplemental GABA might be helpful. I guess maybe this is a little tangential, but someone with panic disorder is likely to exhibit
aversion behavior that can lead to agoraphobia. And I think that facing your triggers in a way that does not over-trigger you is extremely important to preventing aversion behavior that leads to agoraphobia. So, otherwise, like if you avoid triggers in life, but especially in panic disorder, you will get more and more triggers leading to more and more things you avoid. And that is a recipe for complete degeneration of mental health. But at the same time, the optimal learning zone is always a certain bit outside your comfort zone, but not too far out. Otherwise, you can feel abandoned and that can provoke, negative reactions. So you have to ideally work with a therapist, but if not, just be very self-aware in terms of what is too much exposure, and yet also be very vigilant to not ever operate within your comfort zone, except when you need a break from operating outside your comfort zone on the weekend or something. So, okay. Forrest, I hope that helped.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. As a bonus, you also get to participate in monthly private Zoom Q&As with me. You can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled out as Q&A, for a 10% lifetime discount. For the remainder of 2020, I will be working full-time on finishing my Vitamins and Minerals 101 book while reserving a portion of my time for consulting clients. You can pre-order my book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. I will try to respond to comments here when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.